Hello, my name is Danny Casolino. We're going to go through the process of creating a dependency injection framework which is blazingly fast, and the reason is for starting this from scratch rather than using one of the many ones available is that after some initial testing I found out that most of them are created with different scenarios in mind, which include using them on the desktop, and the one we're going to be created is going to be highly optimized so that it can also run very fast on the compact framework, which is a constrained execution environment where every bit of IL that has to be jitted has an impact on performance. So we're going to focus on how to do this in the most performing way possible. And we're going to do this on true TDD fashion so that you can also see how the technique can be applied on a rather interesting problem domain. So the first thing I'm going to do is go and create the code name for this project is going to be Funq, but this is something that's going to come out with the next version of the mobile client software factory, and it's probably be called something like container model or something like that. But let's call it Funq, which is fancier. And so let's first create the two projects here. We have the library, then funq.tests, test project. Let's add a reference from the test project to the main library one, get rid of the default classes there, and off we go. So the first thing is let's set up a very basic scenario. Let's call this container fixture because we'll probably have a class which is going to be called container. And before we get into how we're going to solve this problem, let's just create a new test class here. I don't know why it's not adding the reference to the proper Visual Studio unit testing framework, but no worries on that. Let's go and add it. Visual Quality Tools unit testing framework. The reason I'm using the Visual Studio testing framework is that that's the one that is supported by the only one that supports the compact framework natively, so that's going to come in handy when I have to port this for the compact framework, which is going to be just changing the project types and all that. So let's say let's think about the problem creating instances, right, of your objects. Of course, let's say you have a very basic model here. Let's do a public interface. This is going to be the typical nonsense public interface, ifoo, ibar, that we all love to write. Of course, I will leave it to you to imagine a more useful scenario, but let's do the bar and the foo, which implements ifoo. And let's say this guy has a dependency on ibar, and the dependency is received in the constructor, and basically here in the constructor we just go and set the bar, the local bar. Okay, so the first thing is of course the fastest way of doing this is the way you do it typically, right? You do bar equals new bar, right? And it's not boo, it's bar. You declare a new bar, then you do a new foo, and you pass in the bar. And of course, that's going to be the fastest way possible in .NET to create objects. Now, the whole point of dependency injection is that foo shouldn't care which bar it's being passed in, and by the time you are newing up a foo, you might not want to actually instantiate the whole graph, but rather externalize that to somebody to take care for it. The basic idea is you move that responsibility to a container, and basically the container decides which instances you get, and that gives you flexibility in changing the implementations of those dependencies, either at runtime or at configuration time for your application, and you don't have to change anything in the behavior that depends on foo because it will be getting the bar from wherever, from the container typically. So the first and the most typical way of externalizing these new keywords is basically doing the activator.createInstance, right? Now, activator.createInstance will get the first, I think it's the default constructor for the class. Now, or the first constructor if there's only one. In this case, it will fail because we are trying to create an instance and we are not passing the bar. So we would have to do the same thing, activator.createInstance in the bar. How would we do that in a generic way? Well, typically we would walk the constructors in full, find out which is the one that has the most arguments, and for each argument we're going to do the same, and then do activator.createInstance on all of them, so that you get your object graph. Activator.createInstance has a very high cost in terms of performance in the compact frameworks specifically. Reflection is prohibitively expensive, so this is not an option. So the other option is you can go and say I'm gonna have a bar factory and basically specify that this is gonna be a lambda. Now the cool thing of lambdas is that this is not executed at this point, so we are not newing up a bar at this point. We are just declaring a delegate that we can invoke, and at that point this code will run. So when we do bar2 equals bar factory like this, we can call it as a method or do the invoke on it, which is the same thing. At that point this delegate will run and we will get a new instance. And you can do the same with the foo, of course. And because foo needs a bar, we can do bar factory.invoke to pass the bar. So in this case we have externalized the new of the bar from here into a delegate. So you can see where this is going. The core idea is there is a container that will be receiving registrations for the factories that create objects, and then it will take care of hooking up the dependencies on those objects and do that in a way which is high performing. So let's start in true TDD fashion here and say we can register register type and get instance, right? So what we want to do is, as I mentioned, we're going to probably have a container class somewhere. And we are going to do container.register ibar, and what we are going to register is the function that will do the new of the bar. Next we want to retrieve that bar from the container doing container.resolve ibar, and we can assert that we didn't get a null, and it's true that the bar is indeed an instance of a bar concrete type, which is the thing we are newing up here, right? So let's go and create the container class. Container is going to be pretty straightforward at this point. We'll have public void register service, and we are registering a func of the t service, which we'll call the factory for that guy. Now we need a way to resolve it, so we'll have also a public t service resolve t service, and that should return something. For now, let's return the default for a t service and see what happens. Okay, so now our code will compile, of course, but it will not pass, okay, because we get a null from here. So let's go and implement this. How do we return a non-null? Well, first we need a dictionary to keep the factories, this type that maps the type of the service to the factory, the corresponding factory. We'll use object there because there's no, this is a delegate, so there's no base class for a generic func, so we'll just have to cast it when we need it. And let's call this the factories. And now here we can do factories.add type of the service and the factory. Alright. And from here we can retrieve the factory from the dictionary. Type of the service. There's some error handling that we might want to do that later. We will need the test to fail before we can do that. So for now we're gonna say return cast factory to the type we know it is, because this is the only way of registering a factory, so we don't need to check that the actual type that has in, that is in this that dictionary matches, because we know it does. So we'll cast the factory and finally do the invoke, which gives us the instance that we need. Going back here, we go and run, and now we fail. Why? Because we are still getting a new return factory.invoke. Did we actually compile the dependent project? Assert. Oh, is null. Is not null. Is what we should be testing for. There we go. Pass. Now. Now let's get to the other issue, which is injecting the dependency in the constructor for the foo. So let's go on and create another test and say inject dependencies. Registering types and injecting dependencies. So what we are going to do here is the container. If this is registers, this should be worded as a registering types gets dependencies injected. Resolve gets dependencies injected. That's better. New container, and now let's go and register the bar there. Container.register. Now we need to register the foo, and here comes the thing. How do we get a bar there? Well, ideally we would like to get the bar from the container itself, and we could do this container.resolve ibar. The problem with doing this is that here, from within the function, we are referencing an object which is defined outside, that is called a closure. So the compiler will have to generate a class that keeps that reference so that it's available when we invoke this delegate. We don't want that to happen. So a typical approach to this is to actually have the function receive an argument, which is the container that we need to use at that time. And we can do the same with the other one. So we will have to slightly modify the register method, so that now instead of receiving a function that just returns the type, it receives a function that can receive the container as an argument. So this is going to be a function of container, comma, the service. So it's a function that receives the container as an argument and returns a service. So here we will need to cast accordingly. Container service, and basically the invocation will pass ourselves. This allows the delegate here to receive this instance of the container and use that to resolve the other one. The other, we can actually set here a breakpoint so that you can actually see that happening. If I press F9 now, Camtasia will go pause. So we're gonna do that. We're not gonna do that. Let's go and run this. Next, we need to assert that is not null of what? We need to return the foo. Foo equals container.resolve of I foo. And so foo is not null. Let's also get a reference as a foo so that we can access the this property here, bar, and let's assert that the bar is not null, so that we actually did get the dependency injected. Let's run this. Test results, pass. So that's it, we have it working there. Let's I'm trying to think how to set up a breakpoint there. Let me see if I can change the let's see that later. So so basically this is the bare, absolutely bare minimum DI container that you can have. It's not very smart, it has only one very simple approach. It doesn't manage the life cycle of the instances, like reusing them at the container level. It doesn't support container hierarchies or named services and the like, but we're gonna get there on the next screencast. But so far this is pretty like the bare bones 15 minute container that you can have. Thanks, and see you on the next one.